Hey there, folks. Welcome to the Crazy Libertarian with you on your Wednesday morning commute on 88.1 FM. That is KPPP. That is three P's right there. LP. The call-in number is 701-566-0917. Please do not touch the knob from the dial because we have, well, I'll give the shout out to the station here a little bit. They've been on a lot of interesting stuff. You're probably going to like what you hear. But, we've got some not so fun stuff to talk about today. So, if you've been following the news in the last 24 to 48 hours, and man, pardon me, kind of hopes that you haven't been, but we got some bad news that's, well, bad, not really surprising news, I guess. Like, you know, disappointed but not surprising. It came from the Washington Post. They got into a very extensive legal battle over years. And what they did is they looked at secret government documents that came out from the Office of the Inspector of the Attorney General for Afghanistan. They did some studies in about 2014, conducted hundreds of interviews, the Afghanistan papers, tons and tons of stuff like that. And what we found out, more or less, is that even though the government from day one has said that we're not going to get engaged in nation building, we're going to go win this war, things are looking positive, we're helping the Afghani people, they love us, it hasn't been so. They've been lying since day one. And while that might not be surprising to some of you that have started to think about this stuff a little bit, it's really important. And not only is it, like, important to talk about this stuff, but just the massive scale that they've been doing this on, really, like, I mean, as a principled libertarian and a person who loves my country and hates seeing innocent Americans and civilians around the world die, I'm angry and frustrated. But as, like, a student of political science, I'm like, wow, you guys pulled that off for a while. That's pretty interesting. Is there like an Emmys for that amongst dictators that we can be in the running for now? There's got to be something that we can get out of this nonsense, right? I mean, $1 trillion got to get you at least one nice trophy. But I digress. So let's kind of go over this, right? So when we're talking about this conflict, we have had the same basic talking points from each and every president at the outset of their presidency. What a lot of people forget about George W. Bush is that a big reason that he won is that when he was debating Al Gore, he ripped the Democrats to shreds for nation building in Somalia, in Eastern Europe, that kind of a thing. And he said, from day one, we're going to go in, we're going to take out the terrorists, we're not going to do nation building, blah, blah, blah. 8 years later, and the Democrats take over, and Obama comes in. Day one, he says, we're going to be out, we're not going to be doing any nation building, blah, blah, blah. 8 years later, the tide turns. Trump comes in and in a much, much, much less articulate manner says, we're not going to do any nation building, blah, blah, blah. Well, we're almost 4 years into it and we're still nation building. So we're dealing with an 18 year long, think about that, 18 years. There are people that are signing up for the Marines, for the Army, for all branches of the military that weren't even alive when 9/11 happened. There are people that had to learn about why they're going to die in this stupid, pointless war, because that's how long we've been dragging it out. Let's bring the numbers back for a second. More than 750,000 Americans have gone to serve at least one tour of duty in Afghanistan since that war started. More than that. Many of them multiple times. Throughout those tours, we've had 21,000 injured and more than 2,300 dead. In addition to the immense human cost, families broken up, soldiers never coming back, not to mention the 22 suicides a day that are attributed to PTSD from some of these war zones, we've spent over $1 trillion on this conflict. So, what did we really get out of it? Nothing. And what's really even more surprising about this, right? What's more stunning about it is not only did we get nothing out of it, but the people that when you went to vote for them, when you turned on the news, when anything happened that always promised the best outcomes and said that we're winning and everything that we heard over this whole gigantic quagmire and lie that was the Afghanistan war, they knew that it wasn't working. And if they thought that it might work, well, guess what? They quickly learned that it wouldn't. By the way, this isn't just me saying this. This is the Washington Post and what is essentially the Pentagon Papers 2.0. So I want to be very clear about this. This report is probably the biggest piece of journalism in the last decade, arguably in my lifetime. If you haven't read it, I really recommend getting that 99-cent, 4-week subscription to the Washington Post. Totally worth it. So, other than, like, dropping bombs and waging wars, what was the American... what was our number one focus in Afghanistan? We essentially printed money on it. We threw money at the situation and had no idea what to do from the very beginning. It was just insane. And here's the crazy thing about how corrupt this was, right? We'll get more into this. But at some points, U.S. aid in some districts in Afghanistan was totaling $3 million a day. At one point throughout the interviews, an unnamed, I believe he was some type of an officer in the army, was talking to a United States congressman, and the congressman, and he mentioned to the congressman that what would you do with $3 million a day in your area? And he said, well, that would be too much for us. I don't know what we'd do. And he said, okay, well, I'm doing that in an area where people live in mud huts. Think about this. Think about the sheer incompetence and just utter ego and arrogance that got us in this situation to just throw money at it. You're, by the way, very hard-earned money. I can't speak for every county in America, but I definitely know a few in northern Minnesota and rural North Dakota that would like $3 million more a year for essential road services. But nope. We burned it away in Afghanistan. Oh, and by the way, in addition to blowing this, because obviously when you like throw money at something, it goes somewhere, right? I mean, we're paying more for college, even though we're not necessarily earning more because of college or anything like that, but we sure do have a lot more administrators, right? So where's the money in the war Afghanistan war going? It's going into corruption that's increasingly fueled by the United States' own policies. When the United States came into Afghanistan, they decided to tear up the history book and do what Western countries tend to do in these situations and instill their perfect playbook of liberal democracy and all that stuff and a centralized government in an area that had traditionally been very, very diverse, decentralized, and based on power sharing, not centralized authority. So this money would go out, and it was primarily picked up by corrupt officials who would use it to, you know, give positions and influence to their friends and family, because that's how the Afghani social scene works very loosely, or it would go to overpriced contractors. So think about that. $3 million a day in just one district. Multiply that by 20, 30 districts times 18 to 20 years. The numbers are staggering, and they knew about it for decades. That's the part that I'm going to keep reiterating here. It's not like they tried, and it's not like they went in with like these ideas that they could win, and they just took a tough break. They knew that they weren't going to win that damn war, and they kept sending poor people like me and you, people increasingly from rural communities like North Dakota and Minnesota, to fight and die for this nonsense. They knew they couldn't win, and they still dragged us there in the first place. So, what strategy did they have at all? Oh, and real quick also, because of their influence on the Afghan economy and their poor handling of the situation, they also influenced another common topic on the show, the heroin epidemic, by massively increasing opium production, because it seems that the only thing that our government can do when it comes to drug consumption is increase its output and make it less safe. But I digress. So, there were problems from the start, right? Everyone knew it. And not only this, but the entire time that they were there, there was no long-term strategy. The only long-term strategy was to keep lying to us and throwing money at the situation and praying that it would get better. It didn't get better. it certainly didn't get better. And like I said, all of this is a problem that we, and I mean, I don't say we, like, you know, I'm sure that no one listening to this radio station personally went and demanded that we get into a war with Afghanistan or anything like that, but our government, all that, created. There's a quote here from Bob Crowley, a United States colonel, and he was talking about how they manipulated data to make it seem like we were winning. And he said, and I quote, "Every data point was altered to present the best picture possible." Think about that. Every single data point that was happening. They manipulated everything. When there were increased terrorist attacks at first, they were like, oh yeah, it's because there's more American troops on the ground, therefore more targets to shoot at, more attacks. When there were increased suicide bombings, they said, oh, that just means the Taliban's getting desperate. And by the way, in order to get understand how crazy this whole nightmare of a situation was, our human intelligence was so bad that our troops on the ground didn't know who the bad guys were. I'm going to be making a lot of allusions to Vietnam today, but even in Vietnam, we had some slight idea that there were these guys called the Viet Cong. We weren't even sure if we were fighting Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, various warlords. It was a shifting sea, and we were totally, totally unprepared for it. And they manipulated the picture the entire way along, which is absolutely ridiculous. Think about this. For almost two decades, they have been making a conscious choice to continually make the situation look better than it was so that they can keep stealing money from you and me, that they can keep sending innocent Americans to die for no strategic purpose. Folks, if that's not exactly what this country was intended to never be, then I don't know what the hell it was. If our Constitution allows that, why do we even have the damn thing anymore? Honestly, they can just lie to us for 20 years and get away with it? What's the point? I thought that a free country won the Cold War. That doesn't sound like winning the Cold War. That sounds like what the Soviets did 30 years ago. That we also funded, which later became the group that, you know, attacked us on 9/11, that got us into Afghanistan. So it's not like we totally didn't have a historical precedent for not wanting to get in here, seeing the long-term implications. But think about this. They knew that they were lying, they knew that it wasn't going well, and they just kept on dragging it on to manipulate you and I. Folks, I've talked on the show about what it means to honor our veterans. I think the very least that we could do is let them know what the hell they're signing up for when they get involved with these wars. But even that's apparently too much to ask from our government. And that's a sad reality that we are all paying for. And let me take a little bit of a detour here. And like I said, I am doing my best to kind of give some analysis and some depth to this, break it down a little bit. Go home and read this report. If you want the government that they, and I don't even want to call this a blunder. This isn't a blunder, because blunders are like accidental. Like, your first DUI is a blunder. Your fifth or eighth or tenth is a very serious problem. And someone needs to take the damn bottle or the damn car keys away from our government, because they keep driving drunk with this. It's so insane. John Sopko, head of the Office of the Investigative General for Afghanistan Reconstruction, said that the American people have constantly been lied to since the Afghanistan war started. Think about that. Constantly been lied to. Not they were lied to more during red years or blue years or this or that. I would like to reiterate that everyone who got so fired up about 2016 for Trump, or how Trump was, you know, literally Hitler and blah, 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 or people that got fired up about Obama and hope and change, or, you know, all of that interesting stuff, as we lean into 2020 and hear more of those things arise, we didn't do a damn thing differently. We don't have a two-party system in America. We don't have a two-party system in Washington. We have a one-party system. That's the military-industrial complex party, and they seem to run everything, because they can get away with ripping you and me off for $1 trillion over 18 years and sending people to die with, by the way, plenty of people knowing that it's not going to work, and yet we're not even questioning it. We're not even trying. We're not putting up any resistance. We're doing nothing. This is just ridiculous. And I don't mean to like imply that this was started with really good intentions and then they got overwhelmed. It was a man that I haven't talked about nearly enough on this show, Donald Rumsfeld. He was, of course, one of Bush's top crony cabinet members. Anything bad that you can say about the Republicans can be, or that you can say about the Republican Party at that time frame can be pretty squarely dropped, if not on his lap, then near it. But he was already sounding the alarm 6 months after the war started that he didn't even know, by the way, one of the engineers of this conflict, that he didn't know who the hell we were even fighting. Since that realization that he had no idea who the hell we were fighting, we've been there for 17 and a half more years. So think about this. I don't mean to say that this is some type of problem that can be solved with an election or with a policy or with anything like that. We have a very serious systemic problem here, and we've had it for a very long time. As a matter of fact, the report actually goes on to show that we had no strategy. We didn't know what was going on. We had, according to Donald Rumsfeld at one point, we were acting on zero human intelligence. Think about that. No one had the intelligence, and yet they continually lied in public about how victory was assured, the locals were loving us, and things were going so well. And then, and let me once again bring this back. I talk a lot about how 9/11 changed America, and a lot how we've effectively become a different country since then. There's been some stuff, and you know, that wasn't the only act that got us to the spot that we're in, but we've definitely become more of a security-dependent people. The people that created this apparatus in order to fight the terrorists, the people that needed to see every email you've ever sent, every phone call you've ever made, every text message that you've ever done, the people that need the money to fight the wars, that say that it's a matter of national security, that will call you un-American if you question this stuff, that say that you hate your country if you question this stuff. That's a real charge that you can get levied at if you say this in some crowds, have known that they were lying about this from the start. All the while, hyping up in the immediate aftermath of 9/11 that it was America first, we're going to get the terrorists, we will unite, we will succeed, and they will keep throwing smoke bombs and keep taking from you and me. And that's exactly what they did. Now, it would almost kind of be nice if it was like the only problem that we had was we didn't know who we were fighting. Right? Maybe eventually we could luck, you know, even a blind squirrel gets a nut every once in a while, maybe we could luck into something, but that's not good enough for the United States government. A couple of deadly and expensive blunders is nowhere near enough for these morons. Because at the same time, what we were doing, as I mentioned earlier, is heavily centralizing the Afghanistan government, because we, in our infinite knowledge, decided that they should base it off of our government. And by the way, I'd like to point out that the guy that the people picked in order to actually become president was a former CIA asset. I'm talking, of course, about Kazari. He was known for, like, he was bald, and he always had that, a very distinct, I forget the exact phrase for it, but he was, prominent in Afghani politics in that time, and he was a CIA asset, so, there again are our friends at the CIA cropping up suspiciously when trillions of dollars and thousands of Americans go missing. Totally not a overlap there. Pure coincidence, people. Please don't ask any questions. But think about this. Afghanistan, a little history here, has always been, because of its geography, everything about the place, has always been a very decentralized, broken up country. And that's what's, in addition to the geography and all that other stuff, made it very, very hard to conquer. Alexander couldn't do it, the British couldn't do it, the Russians couldn't do it, and we evidently can't do it. But we thought that we had this idea that we were going to turn a country that was poor, and with And to be clear, when I mentioned how like poor and isolated Afghanistan was, there were people that thought that had never heard of America, that didn't know that the Russians invaded 30 years ago, and that thought that the king was still in power when the Americans invaded. They were still loyal to the king until the 21st century. They knew nothing. So how the hell are you going to take a country with that kind of backdrop, with decades of civil war, absolute poverty, and turn it into a Western liberal democracy? Well, and we probably could have had this discussion 20, about 18 years ago if anyone would have cared to have the damn discussion after they pulled the wool over our eyes. But the answer is that you probably can't. And all that we've done is thrown money at it because these people, the government has never had support. It's not like they magically lost it because we got involved. These people didn't even know who the government was. And let's bring it back even further. One of the big things and the big central requirements of their aid, from those in the West, was that we have to have this grand infrastructure and we have to have tons of education and all this other stuff that we in the West would like to spend money on. But do you know what happens when you try and take a nation of subsistence farmers and get them to send their children to school? Not great things. So do you know what we did with all these great intention programs? We gave them a bunch of white elephant gifts and increased resentment towards the new, unfamiliar, and uncomfortable centralized government at your expense. To be clear, these people were, I mean, some of these people had not been contacted by substantial outside groups in well over 50 years. And we went in there thinking that we could have a sure victory, a quick victory, and we wouldn't even need to rebuild. Nonsense. This is, and by the way, like, I want to be very clear here. Everything that I'm saying, a rational person, if you were to have this discussion about a theoretical, whatever, a theoretical country, would say that this doesn't make sense and that, for lack of a better term, it's insane. There's no strategy here. We're wasting billions of dollars. People are dying. You know what the United States government did 2 years into this badly managed mess that was Afghanistan? We went in and decided that it'd be, while we were in the neighborhood, we'd grab another country on the way out, you know what I mean? And then we got involved in another decades-long conflict, which would later result in the insurgency in Iraq, later the rise and fall of ISIS, and all this stuff which is still being felt today. By the way, I could do a whole nother hour-long episode on Iraq. I'm not going to go that far into it, though, except to say that in addition to not learning seemingly any lessons from Afghanistan, which is a tragedy in and of its own right, are idiotic leaders. I mean, think about this. Like, going in and actually invading a country, especially if you feel like you're going to be there for some period of time, is a substantial investment, even for a superpower like us. There's a reason that the Afghanistan invasion was one of the reasons that the Soviet Union later fell. However, in our great genius, we decided that we'll just do this again in another poor, isolated country and make the exact same mistakes. Because a lot of things I'm saying about Afghanistan also carried through to Iraq. They tried to set up a democratic parliamentary system with a very centralized government in a place that was used to power sharing and local control. This led to very deep divisions and eventually led to violence and led to people souring on the entire idea of democracy. And here's the really crazy thing, right? And some of you are going to gasp, I'm sure, as you're watching or listening. But one of the big things that they did is they went in and they demanded that Afghanistan just shift into the markets of the 21st capitalist liberal democracy world. And listen, I'm all about 21st century markets, right? This is awesome. I love this world. However, the last time that the Afghanis had any sense of stability was for a brief period of time from when the communists were in control. So many people were more comfortable and familiar with the communist system. But did the neocons and later the neoliberals and then later the weird populist movement that whatever the hell Trump is listen at all? Did they try and go into what the locals might have been interested in, had some success with that we could begin transitioning? Nope. just to a straightaway free market economy. There was one Afghan officer or senior official named in the, I don't believe he was named in the report. They corroborated some names. Just for the record, the Washington Post is still waiting on a federal ruling to see if they can get all this information. So it's kind of a work in progress. But, and he said, effectively, what are we going to do? Sell a few grapes on the international market? Afghanistan was so poor that, like, any idea that they could enter into a fruitful 21st century democracy was just arrogant and blatantly false. And I want to be clear about all this. None of this takes more than, like, a 5 or 10 minute thinking over of the situation to see that, with what we know that they knew, this was never going to work. This was never, ever, ever going to work. And yet we kept throwing more and more fuel on this fire and kept getting ourselves invested in everything. And the more that we twitched, the more that we tweaked, the more that we changed things, the worse and worse it got. And Afghanistan really still hasn't recovered to this day. And like, just the colossal amounts of money that these people wasted and the processes and how they did it is even for someone that has to see a lot of very, let's call it angering activity to me when I'm driving around and during road construction season and I see 8 people around a hole with 3 of them working. They knew about the corruption in Afghanistan. They knew, I think at one point we spent $22 million on one gas station in rural Afghanistan. And this was just happening over and over again. One senior U.S. official compared it to pouring water into a funnel, into a bucket. It is like, a little water is good. Yes, a moderate amount might even be great. But when you do too much, the water overflows and you start flooding. Well, guess what? We flooded Afghanistan with bombs, troops, and money. And all that came out of it was resentment, more extremism, corruption, and American dead soldiers. And yet we are still there. And like I said, to reiterate, every president at the beginning of their presidency, in their own little unique way, all promised to the American people that, oh my gosh, we're going to get out. I swear to God, we're going to get out of Afghanistan. We're going to be gone. We're not going to nation build. We're going to get the terrorists and we're going to stop. And they all lied. Do you know how much, like, think about this for comparison, everyone knows the Marshall Plan, right? That when post-World War II America spent billions of dollars rebuilding Western Europe and turning it into Western Europe, right? Like the other roughly third of the first world. Adjusted for inflation, we spent way more than the Marshall Plan in Afghanistan. And what have we gotten for our money? I'm not really sure. I don't think that anyone can answer. I really, really wish that I could, but I just don't think it can be done. So, this is Bradley Foster. I'm going to be right back. I'm going to let you marinate in that one. 2,300 dead, 21,000 wounded, 22 soldiers a day committing suicide, $1 trillion lost. If you can think of even one positive impact for our country, I encourage you to call in and tell me I'm wrong, because folks, I just don't see it. This has been Bradley Foster with the Crazy Libertarian. I'll be right back. Hey there, folks. You are back on the Crazy Libertarian 88.1 FM after that beautiful musical outtake by Sturgill. So, and I know that everything that I've talked about, I hope it's kind of kicked around in your brain a little bit, but I would like to bring in one more thing that I've talked about a whole lot on this show. I wanted to give it a little extra time. Because it's something that certainly pisses me off with the experience that I've seen and the incredible harms done in our country. So the United States government, for pretty much the last century, has had this hard, hard line on heroin in particular is one of the harshest drugs. And if we catch you with it, we will punish you. If we catch you selling it, we will ruin your life. We will take your house. We will send your father to jail if he has a habit and happens to be caught on his way to work because whatever the situation may be. We've wasted hundreds of billions of dollars not only on building prisons and police officers' time, but the amount of money that we're spending that these people could be, like, if they were free and taking care of themselves, that we wouldn't have to spend, and all the tax revenue, and so many things. We've been over this. Prohibition sucks. Prohibition really freaking sucks. But So what did our federal government do about this delicate situation? So as you may have heard, you may not have, Afghanistan actually produces an insane amount of the world's heroin, because a lot of the poppies grow very, very well in that region, and that's one of the only things that they can really successfully grow year-round and stuff like that. And so what did the United States do? And mind you, growing poppies has gone on and off for generations in Afghanistan. It's a cultural thing. Like I said, it is to that area like tobacco is to parts of Kentucky and Tennessee and all that other wonderful cancer-causing stuff. So at first, the British actually did something on the initiative here, and they went in and they would actually pay farmers to destroy their opium crops. Awesome, right? They'll burn the poppies, there won't be any more heroin, cool. Of course, the farmers, after seeing that incentive, decided that they would start growing more opium so that they could make more money from burning more opium. So the British stopped that. Later on, the United States actually got more involved and actually went in and just burned opium fields without absolutely any compensation. Just said, hey, even though this isn't really our country, this is illegal, there goes your livelihood. What do you think these people did? Do you think that they might have reacted the way that Nancy Reagan, as she rolls over in her grave hearing this, imagined that American school children would when they were told to just say no and were stopped and arrested by that awfully nice police officer and say, you know what, you're right, drugs are bad, we'll start over. Well, if you have any experience with the war on drugs in America, you know that's not how that worked. So what effectively happened is that some people that never had reason to get concerned or involved with anything related to the Taliban now suddenly had a very real and very promising reason, even if they didn't support the Taliban per se, to hate the United States of America. This, in addition to all the drone bombings and et cetera, that we've been doing. So what did the United States effectively do? We, with a series of bumbling strategies, managed to both increase opium production while decreasing local trust for us. Shocker. Now, when you factor in the massive corruption that we talked about earlier, you get into situations where almost every official, bureaucrat, judge, whatever it may be in the country is taking bribes. And suddenly, it's like you have the American government spending billions of dollars on these entities. The government, or the Afghanistani army, the Afghani government, all that stuff. You have them also spending billions of dollars to eradicate the opium problem. Well, then, because of the destabilization that we caused and all that other stuff and the graft and the fact that the locals didn't trust us because we just took their family's entire earnings and burned it up, the local people just further didn't care. And because opium was the moneymaker, that's what they started to do. And because the United States was trying to do everything at once and therefore had absolutely no strategy, assuming that any prohibition model can work here, by the way, it can't, as this is an excellent illustration of, they failed. United States failed on a really massive level. And what happened? Heroin flowed out of the country at the same time that the prescription problem was taking off in the United States. And then another decade or so down the line, we're stuck with a very serious fentanyl problem. So think about that. Not only are we wasting our troops' time, not only are we wasting their lives, not only are we doing that horrible stuff, we're waging a war on our own citizens. My God, how many people have to be shot by the cops over some nonsense interaction for drugs before we stop this stuff? How many people have to be torn apart? How many people have to be sentenced to prison, solitary confinement, for having a plant or a freaking substance that they weren't forcing anyone to take? How many people have to die before we can at least stop funding one of the largest sources of this on Earth? Do you see how incredibly angering this is for us? We're all paying for this. We are all chipping in. We're all being told by our government that they will ruin our lives if we so much as touch this, while they protect and encourage the drug dealers. Absolutely ridiculous. And you know, this is a very avid comparison on this heroin point in particular, because something similar actually happened during Vietnam. Soldiers would get hooked. It was called the Golden Triangle in the 60s and 70s. Tons of heroin came from the Southeast Asia at the time. And that's just one of many comparisons that I'd like to make between Vietnam and Afghanistan. During both Vietnam and Afghanistan, we didn't know who the hell we were fighting. Our troops weren't very, didn't have a whole lot of morale, and it seemed like we had no plan whatsoever to either win the war or to actually get out of the war. But other than the obvious comparisons, you know, like the fact that we're sending people to die in pointless wars that were based off of initial assumptions. In Vietnam, we had the Gulf of Tonkin incident. In Afghanistan, we had some very rough decision-making in the wake of 9/11 and greatly expanded state powers and budgets and all this stuff. You know, we're backing bad actors on both sides, we're engaging in tons of corruption, we're siding with objectively bad people because we're fighting people that to us look a little bit worse. It's all a mess. But you know the one thing that Vietnam did have, America? And this one isn't me even talking to the policymakers. This isn't me talking about those SOBs who I've been ranting about for the better part of this program's history. Thanks again to the nice folks at 88.1 for letting me on air. They somehow haven't gotten shut down because of it yet, so I'll keep ranting for a little bit longer, I suppose. This is on us, folks. This is on you and me. Have we become so numb to this stuff that we can't even be shook by anything anymore? What's it going to take? Because Vietnam, for as hopeless and as bleak as it was, at least there was some unified resistance. We had student protesters, we had, you know, the hippies, we had, at one point, Johnny Cash, we had rock stars coming out, we had all types of people coming out against this war. We had demonstrations across the nation, we had all types of, you know, it's one of the cultural iconic things about the 1960s. What's our generation doing? That's an open-ended question because I haven't seen very many attempts to end this particular war. When Obama came in 2008 and when Trump came in 2016, there were talks that we were going to bring the troops home. But I haven't seen that happen. We're still fighting and dying in Afghanistan every single day. We're still spending money every single day, not to mention Iraq, not to mention Africa. Just this whole... tons and tons of these open-ended little conflicts that we're in. And you know what they all have in common? We have absolutely no strategy. Folks, we have over 10,000 American troops deployed across the African continent right now. Congress has not declared war on anyone in that side of the hemisphere for well over 70 years. So why the hell are we there? So this is another open-ended question because I don't know how my freedoms got to Africa. I would really like someone to be able to tell me, because this is symbolic of a larger problem. We've become so numb to this nonstop, ongoing, pointless, draining war, a heartless, soulless, evil, dirty, there's nothing, people 100 years are going to look now back on us as absolute savages for what we've done. We are not going to get out of this looking nice historically, I can tell you that for a fact. And we're just taking it, slaying down, man. We're not doing anything. We're not even making an attempt to look like we're doing anything. When's the last time they saw an anti-war protest? When's the last time they saw an anti-war t-shirt? Hell, when's the last time that you thought about the war in Afghanistan? It's probably been a little while. And that's on all of us. That's on the culture. That's on the people. Because what got us out of Afghanistan, or what got us out of Vietnam and the... back in the day? Was it because the government realized that their search and destroy policy was failing, or that they thought that they could reach an amicable agreement, or any of that? No. Did the government suddenly, or did one bureaucrat wake up one day and go, oh my god, this is unwinnable, we need to change it immediately? No. Did Richard Nixon get in there after beating LBJ and really strong-arm things into a different situation? No. For the most part in Vietnam, the government did what they're doing in Afghanistan today. Threw money at the problem, threw troops at the problem, threw bombs at the problem. What got us out, folks, was people like you and me. It was people taking to the streets, it was people getting invested in everyday life in order to stand up. I mean, yeah, admittedly they had the draft, which certainly gave a lot more young people more skin in the game to actively oppose the war. but they demanded that the troops be brought home. Why aren't we doing that? Why aren't we even having more discussions about it? It's just incredibly mind-boggling. Folks, I wanna make a rather uncomfortable, let's call it an illustration for you, if I will. How much more money can we keep spending on these wars? How many more troops can we keep killing in these wars? How many more countries are we going to go in to be involved with perpetually? Right now, across the Middle East, we have troops stationed in Syria, we have troops stationed in Saudi Arabia, Iraq, not to mention the tiny Gulf countries like Kuwait, Bahrain, Afghanistan. We may have troops in Pakistan, and not to mention the troops that no one really knows where they are. We have troops in Niger, we have troops all over in Africa, we have troops in Japan, we have troops in South Korea, we have troops in Germany, we have troops in the United Kingdom, etc. So, how long is this sustainable? And when are we going to start doing something about it? Because I've mentioned a lot of things, and the Washington Post did an excellent job in this. Like I said, please, please, please go read the Afghanistan papers. It is, I swear to God, it's going to be the key defining piece of journalism for my generation. I'm almost willing to bet on it. If anyone would like to challenge me on that, you're free to use that call-in number. $20 is in my pocket. Betting on it right now. Meet me again in a decade. We'll shake on it. But how many of these things are happening all over the globe that we're never even getting this much attention? And what is our larger strategy with our armed forces? Is it, in fact, to protect the security and freedom of the United States of America? Or is there something else going on here? Because there's a very, very select group of people that make a lot of money on wars. Contractors, local despots all over the world, the military-industrial complex, all of these people absolutely love the warfare state. So could it be perhaps that old statement, I forget his exact name, but the highest decorated World War I veteran from America went out and said that all wars are bankers' wars? Well, I think in the 21st century, all wars are contractors' wars. Because folks, I'm telling you right now, I haven't seen the internal documents on anything happening in Africa, nor throughout large parts of Asia, nor throughout the Middle East, but I can tell you one thing. I'm willing to bet that we really don't have a strategy about what we're doing with these troops. I'm willing to bet that we don't really know. I'm willing to bet that we're wasting money the way that we're wasting it in Afghanistan all over the country. I'm willing to bet that troops are dying every single day, and very few of us are paying attention. I'm willing to bet that more of them are coming back with PTSD because of these things that the average American, these conflicts that aren't technically wars, but they're a very weird gray area, and we don't even know. And yet you're paying for it, and they are more than happy to keep charging you. So what's the United States government doing about veterans in this country? By the way, after we ask them to fight all these crazy wars, we bring them home, we prohibit them from using certain medications to treat their illnesses, and then we leave them in such a situation that we are still to this day losing 22 a day to suicide. I'd like to kind of shift a little bit to a larger point here for the final few minutes of this program. And I'd like to talk about, obviously we're talking about a lot of military stuff, our general foreign policy, which seriously needs to be rethought. I hope that I've made that clear. If you're still having questions about that, please, once again, I'm going to say this a bunch of more times probably, read the Afghanistan papers. You will not regret it, and you will be pissed off about it. Although probably not very surprised. But, so knowing that they lied to us for decades, people in Congress lied, people in all branches of the government lied, people lied to themselves, they lied to their comrades, all over the place. When the hell are we going to start questioning what the government has grown into over the last 100 years? What boggles my mind is we have such objective evidence that these bastards went out and lied about this and got people killed. You should be mad about that, by the way. Your heart should be elevated when you think about stuff like this, because good people met an early end for, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this on there, but for bullshit. That's what it was. And yet people want to assume that other government actors in different areas of the, you know, whether it be the economy, the regulatory state, whether it be the general surveillance state, whether it be the prison industrial complex, whether it be the push for universal health care or whatever centralization, we trust them on these issues? We already have evidence that our government on a key thing that has spent $1 trillion on this. You know, literally a life or death situation, they're lying to save face. Maybe we shouldn't be so eager to expand access in other directions. Maybe that's something that we should consider for a moment. Because here's the thing. What I really want you to think about today, what I hope that haunts you as you attempt to fall asleep tonight, is if they lied this blatantly on this for 18 years, trillions, all that stuff, what else could they be lying about? Maybe Social Security looks much worse than we think it does and they don't want to spook the markets. Maybe Medicare and Medicaid are massively inefficient and we're not being told something. Maybe a lot of the regulations that are meant for consumer health are really meant to prop up big businesses in a 21st century edition of the Gilded Age. You know what? None of that would be surprising. But guess what? Guess what, America? Guess what, Fargo Moorhead? No one cares about the troops that died in Afghanistan. For some reason, no one cares about the money we're spending, the people that are killing themselves every day in America, every day after they come home, after they serve their country, and we give them a cold shoulder when they get home. I'll say this once again, America, you really don't care about the vets. You really don't give a damn about the veterans in this country, and it's sickening. We should be ashamed with ourselves. We've become such a disgustingly numb culture to this. We should be on our feet demanding change for these people if we actually cared about them. The least we can do is ask these people to fight in conflicts that are worthy of their lives. But even with a life or death situation, they're doing this horrendous and obvious and painstaking lying. What do you think they're doing in areas where we look at even less? What do you think they're doing in the finicky parts of the tax code? Or what do you think they're doing to certain people that they don't like with all of its great and massive expanded powers over the last 100 years? How many other self-serving bureaucrats and politicians are out there running programs that your families depend upon? Some people listening, I'm sure, are living off of Social Security. How would you like to find out because of one report released in the Washington Post or New York Times or whoever feels free to pick up on this hint, 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 and has much more clout than I do, that Social Security is short by 30 or 40% than what they've been claiming? Imagine that one day. That's just what happened with Afghanistan. You all know the scarier thing about Afghanistan? And this whole, there's a word that I want to say, but I can't say it on air, so I'll call it a quagmire. We had warnings that this would happen from early on. Hunter S. Thompson, the great Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas author, said shortly after the attack, something along the lines of, I don't know who will fight, I don't know where we'll fight, but I can guarantee you that we'll fight there for a very long time, and we sure as hell won't win, is effectively what he said. And you know what? He was right. So think, the next time that you hear people calling for increased control over your retirement, over your health care, over anything like that, let's at least be a little more critical. Because you know what this whole Afghanistan fiasco shows us? Americans have been very, very, very good at either deceiving themselves or going along with it because, or whatever you want to say it. But Americans have gotten very good at just going along with things. And maybe when it's happening across the world, we don't really care. Maybe we can afford not to care, you know? Maybe whatever happens in Afghanistan really, at the end of the day, doesn't affect the average American. But maybe a massive, massive shake, maybe a stunning realization that your retirement's running out, or that they've been lying to us on something like, I don't know what causes obesity and then drives obesity to the number one killer of people in America. Oh, yeah, they did that in the 1960s when they blamed fats when the sugar lobby blamed fats for obesity and then got everyone to eat a bunch of sugar. Or maybe something horrible will happen, like they'll try and ban something and then more dangerous versions will come around. You know, kind of like how at one point in this opioid crisis, we had people that were addicted to painkillers and then we took the painkillers away, increasing suicides amongst legitimate pain victims. But let's not talk about those people. Those are more people that we really don't give a damn about, right? Those are more people that Americans, no matter what we say and how high and mighty we act, even those that donate to charity, like, if we cared about these people, we would sure give them a bigger say in their own medical choices, right? But no, it couldn't be that the government, through a series of bad and racist and bigoted and controlling and judgmental and just horrible decisions, decided to ban an entire set of entire sets of substances and then lock people up for no good reason and then later fuel the opioid crisis, right? It's not like that could ever happen, God forbid. What I mean, and by the way, I'm sure that all of those great surveillance systems that they have, the hundreds of thousands of people who are employed for the surveillance state, listening for any signs of trouble, any un-Americanism going on, they're going to, you know, they got to keep us safe. God bless them for keeping us safe, but what else are they doing? And by the way, I'd like to bring it back, really, because I guess on the show I really want to call us all out, because man, we gotta change something. If our Constitution means anything, and if my grandpa meant anything fighting in World War II and all the other great veterans that we've had over the years and all the things that have made America great, which wasn't nationalism or anything that Trump runs on. But until and unless we can start demanding it back, it is not going to get any better. Because guess what? Like they've been lying about Afghanistan, like they've been lying about the drug war, they're likely lying about almost everything else. And folks, that's the scariest part. The scariest part is that how much else are we in the dark about? I mean, if it took the Washington Post 3 years and numerous legal fights to come and release these documents, what else is going on? So, while you're going to bed tonight, just think of all of those awesome government programs that were assuredly meant to help you and help all of us other taxpayers that you're paying for and sometimes people are dying for. And then, just for a moment, think about how they lied to us for 18 years, nonstop, about the condition and timing of the war in Afghanistan. And then go to your bathroom, take a look in the mirror, splash some water on your face, and wake up, America. We've got a lot of things to deal with, and this Afghanistan report is hellish and as shocking and as, oddly enough, unsurprising, if you've been paying attention, as it may be, is just the tip of the iceberg. This has been Bradley Foster with the Crazy Libertarian, signing off. I will see you again next Wednesday morning, and I wonder if we'll even be talking about it by that point. Let's hope we are, America. Let's hope we are.